Welcome to the lecture on special molding processes. So, in this lecture, we will discuss about some of the special type of molding processes, processes where molds are made by some special methods. Among them, we will discuss about full mold process, plaster molding, vacuum molding. Apart from that, there are certain varieties of vacuum molding, then graphite molding. All these things we are going to discuss in this lecture. So, let us start with the full mold process or full mold casting, what we call it as. Now, this is known as a full mold, means the mold basically has the pattern into it. When we are casting and we are trying to pour the molten metal into the cavity, in normal circumstances the cavity is hollow, whereas in this case the cavity is not hollow, rather it is full. So, that is why it is known as the full mold casting. Now, in this case, this cavity is basically filled with certain material that is made from polystyrene. So, that is expanded polystyrene. So, it is also known as expanded polystyrene method. So, expanded polystyrene casting, EPC. So, there are many names to it. So, in that what happens, you make all this pattern as well as the gates and risers attached to the pattern, they are all made from this expanded polystyrene. It is nothing but the polystyrene material in the form of beads, we will discuss later, and they are expanded and they conform to the cavity. So, they are made by machining and fabrication. So, you have the polystyrene, first of all you have these sheets, and from there by machining and by fabrication you are sizing them to the proper pattern shape, and then you are coating that with suitable mold wash so that you are getting the adequate surface properties on that pattern. And finally, you will embed that in a no-bake type of sand. So, basically you have the polystyrene. So, what you do is the pattern that we can see here, the pattern is prepared from pre-expanded polystyrene granules. So, there are pre-expanded polystyrene granules, they are put in the cavity, I mean it is kept in a metallic die, and this die is heated from outside either by steam or by the hot air, and due to that increase in temperature, these granules of polystyrene, they expand on heating. So, they expand and they join together and they conform to the cavity of the die, the shape of the die, and they take a solid shape. So they are, which are injected or gravity filled in the walled aluminum or copper dies, and then we are heating them under steam or in hot water. They expand and join together to form a solid shape conforming to die cavity. So, once you are getting that, that is your pattern. Now, to that you attach these sprue and riser, gates, whatever required for the pouring of the molten metal. Now, so then we are also doing the coatings or we are doing the mold wash so that you have adequate surface finish. Now, when we pour the liquid metal, then this polystyrene material, when it comes in contact with the hot metal, it automatically gasifies. So, suddenly it gasifies, and wherever the molten metal goes, because molten metal is surrounded by these loose sand or no bake type of sand. So, wherever it goes, once it goes there, it basically solidifies, and on the periphery you have this no bake type of sand. So, it gets, so that place where earlier there was polystyrene, it is filled with molten metal. So, we are giving the molten metal temperature normally 25 to 30 degrees C higher, so that it should be able to gasify it, there should not be any traces of the material inside. blow holes and pin holes are prevented. So, because there is no air inside, so because in earlier cases when the cavity is hollow, there is air inside it, you must have adequate measures, or you must ensure that the cavity which is having the air, this air should be thrown off. In this case there is no air, it is filled with this polystyrene pattern material. So, since there is no air, there is no likelihood of having any air related defects like pinholes or blow holes. Now, this method is best suited for one-off casting. So, this method is normally preferred when you get the order of one casting. So, making pattern for one casting, doing everything is a very tedious and it is not at all economical. So, in those cases, or if you at short notice you have to deliver the product, in those cases you go for such methods. So, we can see that you have the formed polystyrene pattern, you have sprue, all that. Then once it is, you are putting the molten metal into it, as the molten metal comes here, it will all gasify. Molten metal comes through it, and wherever molten metal goes, they all gasify and it takes the shape off. So, all this you are getting as the material by which you are casting. So, this is your casting, and this is all that addendums, that is your sprue or pouring basin. So, you are basically getting this product or the cast. So, this is known as full mold casting. Now, there is another sophistication in this process, that is magnetic molding. So, what magnetic molding does, basically the same pattern made of polystyrene, it is kept in a iron sand in a flask. So, embedded in iron sand. So, iron sand is nothing but you have iron salts mixed with iron powder or the, you know, the product of machining. So, that those product, so in that basically iron powder is mixed, and then that is basically giving the support from all the sides, and this pattern is from all the sides enveloped with this iron sand, and then they are basically held together by a magnetic field, so by an electromagnet. Okay. So, what you do is, once you pour the molten metal, then molten metal will go, and wherever it touches on the way to this pattern, then it will go and it will gasify it, and since it is surrounded with iron, so it has a good conductivity, so it will solidify also quickly. And then once you ensure that there is proper solidification, already has solidification is finished, you can remove this magnetism which is being created. So, magnetic field is switched off, and then quickly you are getting the product. So, there is no problem of fettling and other things. So, this way, this is also a variety of, since we are using this magnetic field, it is also known as magnetic type of molding, that is magnetic molding. So, this is about full mold casting or evaporative pattern casting like that. Next is plaster molding process. So, we have heard earlier that plaster is used as a pattern material, but plaster is also used as the molding material. So, we know that the gypsum plaster, when it is mixed with water, it sets and gives hardness. So, in this case you are preparing the mold with the gypsum plaster mixed with water, and also we add the additives, so that you get the desired properties, I mean specific properties what we want to achieve. So, once you are mixing the gypsum plaster with water and the additives, this is in the form of a slurry. So, this slurry is basically poured over the pattern. So, pattern is there, on that this slurry is poured, and this slurry being in liquid state, it has good flowability, it will go in all the corners. So, slurry is poured over pattern, and mold is vibrated so that slurry sets. So, So mold will be vibrated little bit, after some time the slurry will set, in maybe in about 30 minutes the slurry sets completely. Then you can withdraw the pattern and mold is heated maybe close to 200 degrees C for dehydration, all the water is blown off before pouring. Now in this case basically the disadvantage is that it has low permeability. In this case the disadvantage, only disadvantage with this plaster molding is that the permeability is too low. So sometimes what can has been practiced that maybe the mold preparation and pouring you try to do under vacuum. So if you try to do under vacuum, then the possibility of the air related defects, because entering air amount is less negligible. So in that case the defects which are likely to come because of the low permeability issues like gaseous defects, blows, those things, their probability becomes quite less. So in that case you may use the pouring or mold preparation by using the vacuum, or even sometimes you use, you feed the metal under pressure using compressed air. So these two means are used maybe in this, so that the issue of permeability is not there. Now in this case, because its refractiveness is not so high, so normally we restrict casting of non-ferrous materials by when we try to use this plaster as the molding material. Now further, because its conductivity is too low, so the chilling tendency is not there. If the conductivity is higher, the rate of heat transfer through the mold surface will be higher. Like what we have seen in the sand, the conductivity is not so high, but if we take the molding material as the metal, the conductivity becomes quite high. So in that case, in the case of plaster also, the conductivity is quite low. So because of that, the chilling tendency is quite low. So chilling is not there, and since the heat transfer is very slowly, so liquid metal remains in liquid for longer amount of time, and that ensures that even in the finer sections, the thinner sections, liquid metal will go easily. So in this way you can have thin sections cast easily, and plaster anyway the surface has a very good finish. So good precision, with good precision and good finish you can obtain the casting. So that is the advantage of plaster molding. So you can see the schematic, you make the slurries, pour on the slurries on the pattern. Once you get these two halves, you have the portion from where, I mean screw through, and then you have the pouring basin through which you pour the metal and it comes and gets solidified. Now vacuum molding process, the name indicates that you use vacuum to make the mold and then the pouring is done. So in this case the advantage is that there is no use of binder and moisture. So first of all, the problem related to binders and moisture, that is gone. The cost, basically on the cost aspect also you can see the benefits. Then mold preparation is done by dry sand, and compaction and cavity shape by use of vacuum. So you have a dry sand, the compaction or basically keeping the mold at its position, keeping the molding material or sand at its position so that you get the desired cavity shape, that is done by using the vacuum. Since you have nothing to be taken out, the molding materials like sand, in normal case you have sand mold that is to be broken, there are lot of fettling issues. So these issues are not there because you are using the loose sand, so there is no fettling problem, and you have clean environment because you are not using the binders and moistures which are likely to generate a large amount of gases, it may be harmful. So that way it is clean also. The productivity is quite high, 90 to 100 molds per hour you can make. Now coming to how you do it. So what you do is you have a carrier plate, so you are, that is hollow, and you are putting the pattern on it, then you are putting a thin plastic sheet over it and it is heated so that it is softened and it goes over the pattern. Now this softened sheet which is dropped over the pattern and vacuum created so that the pattern is completely enveloped by this thin plastic sheet. Now double walled flask set on pattern, flask filled with dry sand and vibrated sprue formed, mold leveled, sprue opening and mold top covered with plastic sheet, vacuum applied to flask, sand gets compacted. Now this tells that what is the process. You have a double wall flask set. So flask is, we can have the figure. You have this flask both side. Once you get this, so this here you have a plastic sheet here. Once this plastic sheet goes on it, then on the rest portion you are putting this sand, this loose sand, and further you are completely creating vacuum so that this sand is taking the shape and inside you have a cavity. So this pattern will be taken withdrawn, but this vacuum here will be maintained because you have a layer of the plastic sheet. So you can take the pattern out and you will have a cavity generated. So both way, for the cope portion as well as for the drag portion, you will make the cavity, you will attach them, and then also you will maintain the pressure, I mean vacuum, to be created so that there is vacuum inside. And once you pour, then the, after getting solidification, once you release the vacuum, then this till that time the product has already solidified, so you get the loose sand out. Let us see. So this flask is filled with dry sand and vibrated, then you make the sprue is formed, and mold is leveled, mold is having a level of the molding material, or that is sand. Sprue opening and mold top is covered with plastic sheet so that for maintaining the vacuum you have not to do the extra things. Vacuum is applied to the flask, and because of the vacuum the sand gets compacted. You have to see that sand does not enter into the cavity and also not towards the vacuum machine. Vacuum in carrier plate released and mold is stripped after the solidification is complete. So mold is stripped. Now here there is no solidification, basically cope and drag molds are assembled and having plastic lined cavity. So you have the cope and drag molds which are, you have assembled, so you have the cavity inside and you have the plastic lined cavities there. Vacuum is in the flask is maintained during pouring, and till the casting is solidified you try to maintain the vacuum. So that is requirement, that you have to maintain this vacuum. Once you release the vacuum, the sand drops having clean casting. This sand is loose under the action of vacuum, only they were bounded, so sand gets loose and it will go off and you can take the casting out. So you require a basically special pattern plate and double wall flask for this, so that you have effectively the creation of vacuum, effective ventilating system in the inner face of flask to prevent sand particles being sucked by the vacuum pump, a device for stretching and heating plastic sheet, and a powerful vacuum pump. So these are the devices which are required for this, and then you can go for this vacuum casting. It is seen that it is advised to have two screen of sand. So there should be some coarse sand, more of the coarse sand, 70 mesh size, 70% of that, and then 30% you have 270 mesh size. So this way you have the two kind of, one coarse and one fine sand, so that there is good compaction, good strength, so that it can resist the metallostatic pressure. Then there is vibratory frequency also given for a certain type of cavity or size of the box. So, you have some data given for certain size. So, this way you go for vacuum casting. Now, there is modified vacuum process also. In that, basically you use the EPS pattern, expanded polystyrene pattern you are using, applied with refractory coating, and loose sand grains are poured around the pattern and compacted by vibration followed by application of vacuum for full consolidation. So, in this case what you do is, instead of cavity being the hollow, you have the EPS pattern, on that basically you are putting the loose sand and then try to have the compaction by the use of vacuum. Then vacuum needs to be applied only during pouring and for a short time thereafter. While vacuum process well suited for simple shaped casting. Now, in that case the difference in this modified vacuum process and the earlier vacuum process was that, in the vacuum process you need to have a simple shaped of cavity, whereas if there is complex shaped cavity using this modified process, because you have a pattern, so that requirement maintaining the vacuum inside the cavity is not that much a troublesome job in this case, because it is anyway enveloped with certain pattern material. So, that is why this is a modified kind of vacuum molding process, and in that even complex shaped product can be cast. Then there is one that is known as VRH process. So, it is basically, this vacuum process was also invented in Japan, and here this also was in Japan. Now, in this case what is done is, the it is based on the CO2 process, but here a vacuum is also maintained. So, the reaction or silica gel formation, it is all done under vacuum. So, since there is no air, the hardening is controlled, hardening is fast. So, what is done is, here principle uses dehydration of CO2 molds and their hardening under reduced pressure. So, you have reduced pressure, under that basically you do this dehydration or removal of the moisture from that sodium silicate or CO2 mold. So, flask containing sand compacted over the pattern placed inside a VRH vacuum hardening box. So, you are putting that flask containing this sand, and then after closing, suction is applied and resulting reduced pressure promotes evaporation of water present in sodium silicate. So, water, and I mean there is water in that sodium silicate, water vapor is there. So, that this is basically, water will try to go off. So, because the sodium silicate is mixed with sand for the CO2 process. So, once you reduce the pressure, the water vapor will try to go off. Water present in the sodium silicate, they will try to vaporize and they will try to go off. Now, due to chemical reaction and due to the removal of water, the silica gel will be formed. And this, you may know that in the case of CO2 molding, the silica gel formation is basically giving the strength. So, vacuum replacement is done by injection of CO2 gas. So, once you reduce the pressure and there is vacuum, that basically is compensated by moving the CO2 gas into it, which does the hardening. So, the mold hardness further increases. So, this way you see that one is removal of the water from the silica gel and then further strengthening by the injection of CO2. Strengthening it. So, in this case sodium silicate is consumed only half than the normal portion, normal cases, and also this hardening is very much uniform, because of the reduced pressure condition this hardening is more uniform. Since we are using less amount of sodium silicate, so collapsibility also is better in this case, and reduced amount of Na2O also gives benefits in terms of economical, technical and environmental benefits. So, this is about the VRH process. Now, in this VRH process we can see that we have to use the sodium silicate of molar ratio 2:2 to 2.2, viscosity 50 degree bomb, and then sand is 96% silica, water content 0.5% less than that. And so, these are the requirement of the sand to be or the ingredients to be in the case of this VRH process, that you must have less amount of water, residual Na2 should be quite less, fines should be quite less, because they will increase the amount of binder to be utilized and they will affect the process characteristics. Satisfactory, you have mold strength and collapsibility values are reported in this. Another variety is ceramic molding process. As the name indicates, here we use the ceramic refractories. So, it uses chemicals and ceramic slurries for mold preparation. For all types of cast metal, it is applicable. Even for very reactive metals like titanium and uranium, we use them. It does not require risers, venting or chilling because of the extremely slow cooling rate. In this case, there is extremely slow cooling rate, so you do not require risers. Suitable for making these forging dies, tire molds, dies for plastics, so all this where accuracy is required, all that places you use this ceramic molding, die casting, glass making patterns for cell molding, all that is made by this process. Pattern material can be anyone, like metal, wood or epoxy. So, in this what you do is you make this slurry, you mix this ceramic aggregates, that is nothing but ceramic refractories particles as per the requirement of the properties, and you have a liquid binder that is modified alkyl silicate and alcohol based silicon ester. So, this is one binder which is alcohol based, and when binder begins to set, refractory particles start locking to each other and start getting the strength. And slurry powder will be kept over the pattern, which will set quickly in 3 to 5 minutes because of the solvent being the alcohol, and it goes into all the cavities, no ramming is required, no vibration is required, pattern is withdrawn, and ceramic mass is removed from flask, treated with a catalyst to promote full chemical stabilization. Then further we are heating in the furnace to expel all liquid binder completely, then poured and it is cooled slowly. It is done to 900 degrees C, by mistake it is at 90 degrees C, it is 900 degrees centigrade, after that it is heated and then it is poured and allowed to cool slowly. So, that is about the ceramic molding. Then another variety of this molding is graphite molding, where we use the graphite as the mold. So, graphite is used as molding material for producing steel castings, particularly wheels for railway wagon and coaches. So, graphite is a very good conductor of heat. So, we use the graphite, it has very good ease of machining is there for graphite. So, you can make the molds quite easily. It does not fuse with steel at high temperatures. So, this is also one of the important properties because of which we prefer the graphite to be used for the molding. It has high resistance to thermal shock, low coefficient of expansion and ability to resist distortion. So, that is why we prefer the graphite also for as a molding material. It can be used repeatedly and it gives very good quality, it can be used many times. So, we have discussed about these different kinds of molding processes which are under the special categories. We can even discuss, we will be discussing other special casting processes when we talk about the casting process in future. Thank you.